without further ado, oh, we're getting fancy. It's going up. That must be one thing. Classical Corner with Mark Jonas.
Hi, this is a traditional classical corner. I talk a little bit about classical music. Of course, the theme today is jazz. So, anybody know what's special about February 2nd, 1924? February, I should say.
Groundhog Day?
Huh?
So it's Groundhog Day.
Well, February 2nd, 1924. It's actually about something happened very big, about six blocks from here.
Aeolian Hall?
Aeolian Hall, yes. Rhapsody in Blue was premiered on that day, all right? 1924. What's interesting about that is that Gershwin wrote it in about 4 weeks. Now, because he was approached by Whiteman, who had this idea, this experiment he wanted to do, and he was trying to beat some other people to the punch because they had this in line too. He was going to do a concert of classically conceived music in a jazz idiom by jazz. He wanted jazz writers to write their version of a classical piece. So he wanted a little concerto for the clarinet. With Gershwin, he talked about a little kind of concerto for piano, clarinet. But at any rate, he wanted a piece, and Gershwin said, no, I'm not really interested in that. He thought it was kind of gimmicky, and he didn't know it was going to happen. Well, about 5 weeks before the performance, Ira kind of rushed into the rehearsal that Gershwin was having with someone and said, read this, and it was in the newspaper that Gershwin was writing a new concerto for this big concert that was coming up with Paul Whiteman. And somehow it leaked and got into the paper that he was doing it. So he called Whiteman, and Whiteman said, you must do it, because we're trying to beat these other people to it. It's really important. And so Gershwin said, okay. So he wrote Rhapsody in Blue in about 4 weeks. And the last week was being orchestrated, because they had a week before the rehearsal. So the thing that's interesting about that with what I'm going to play tonight, I'm not going to play Rhapsody in Blue, but I'm going to play some other Gershwin pieces, because this gave Gershwin an appetite for writing classical music. Music in the idiom. He wrote an opera, he wrote a piano concerto in F. He started writing music in this fashion. He started singing. He tried to study with Nadia Boulanger. I believe she turned him down. He went to study with Ravel. He asked Maurice Ravel if he could study with him. Ravel said, excuse me, he turned him down. Ravel turned him down as a student. He said, Mr. Gershwin, he said, may I ask? He said, why would you want to be a second-class Ravel when you could be a first-class Gershwin? And he said, second of all, he said, may I ask how much money you make a year? And Gershwin told him, he said, see, it is I who should be studying with you. So Gershwin developed this appetite for writing music, writing classical music. And it grew, and of course, eventually there was a huge opera, Porky and Bess, which was like one of the pinnacle works, I'd say, of his 38 years as a composer, because there were 38 years on this planet, because he died of a brain tumor at 38. Think of all the music we would have had if he'd lived into his 90s, like Mr. Sondheim. At any rate, Gershwin wrote these three preludes. Now, it's interesting, because a prelude for piano normally is something based on one musical idea, like a Bach prelude. You can hear how the figuration is over and over the same, but in different keys. So you hear a pattern of aura. And Chopin took this same idea and wrote his preludes. The same idea, repeated notes in the left hand. So most preludes by classical composers have a thematic idea or an accompanimental idea that continues throughout the piece and somehow ties the whole piece together. Gershwin's not so much. First of all, he set out to write 24 preludes, as had Bach in every key, major and minor, and as had Chopin, every key, major and minor. But he didn't write 24. He got seven of them written. And of the seven, five were actually headed for publishing, and then ultimately he was playing the five of them. He stopped playing one of them and was only playing four of them, and then ultimately only three were published, and these are the three that were published. Interesting enough, they're not that kind of usual prelude form. They're more of a song form, and that's not surprising considering this Gershwin. Think about all what he wrote. He wrote songs. And so these are in song form, but they mean kind of ABA, you know, a first idea, a bridge, and then back to an extended idea of the A with a coda. So it's a song form, a simple song form. And each of these pieces in it. There are three moves. This kind of a quick, slow, quick, so it feels like a little sonata, the three moves together. But these are the Gershwin preludes. Now, I have the music there. It's interesting because I've known these for years, and I kind of pulled them back up a few days ago and started playing them, and I have them memorized, kind of. So I was kind of, but I thought there were a couple of foggy errors, so I started looking at the music. Never do that. Never look at the music. I'm kidding. I'm kidding because I looked at the music. I saw all these things that slightly changed, all these terrible fingerings that I looked at. Oh, my God. So I changed some fingerings. Not a good idea 3 days before I can play. This morning, I don't have anything. So I'm going to have to go back to just playing by memory or looking at the music, and I think I'll do it by memory because it's more exciting. But these are three preludes by Gershwin, and they're very exciting little pieces. So enjoy.
Thank you. Woo!